Hello and welcome to Byju's IAS. Before we take up today's The Hindu analysis, let's talk about an important notification that was issued by the UPSC yesterday. The UPSC has decided to allow the candidates who are appearing for this year's examination to change their choice of center. This option to change your center is being provided for both the preliminary examination that is scheduled to be held on the 4th of October and as well as for the mains examination that is scheduled to be held in January 21. The UPSC shall be receiving these requests to change the center on its official website by operating two dedicated windows. One window shall operate between the 7th and 13th of July, and the other window shall operate between the 20th to 24th of July. The UPSC shall be accommodating these requests to change the center on the basis of first apply, first allot. The UPSC has decided to provide this option to help out a number of aspirants who have either moved back to their native places or those who have changed their place of residence or their place of work as a result of the pandemic and the lockdown. So those who are looking to change their centers, kindly note down these important details and as well as the dates and the deadlines. So with this, let's get started with the analysis of today's The Hindu newspaper by looking at an article from the front page of the Delhi edition. A major industrial disaster has taken place at the Neyveli Thermal Power Station in Tamil Nadu. An industrial boiler at the Neyveli Thermal Power Station has exploded, resulting in the death of at least 6 workers, and it has caused serious injuries to at least 17 more people. This happens to be the second such industrial disaster at the Neyveli Thermal Power Station, which has occurred in a span of less than 2 months. This also happens to be the 4th or 5th major industrial disaster that India has seen this year, and it brings up the topic of industrial safety, which has been analyzed in complete detail in this editorial on page number 6. See, the frequent occurrence of industrial disasters in India highlights the significance of strictly following the safety protocols. Apart from the 2 back-to-back boiler blasts at the Neyveli Thermal Power Station, we have also seen 2 industrial disasters at Vishakhapatnam. These repeated incidents of industrial disasters and the boiler blast that took place at the NTPC power plant in Raebareli 3 years ago reminds us of the hazardous nature of boilers and furnaces in an industrial setting. See, boilers in particular have been recognized as extremely hazardous industrial equipment. These industrial boilers are primarily used to produce steam, and they operate at very high temperatures and very high pressure. These extreme operating conditions make industrial boilers and hazardous industrial equipment, and they are used in various industrial sectors such as thermal power stations, metallurgical industries, etc. Considering how hazardous boilers can be, they are supposed to be very strictly regulated under the Indian Boilers Act. The objective of this legislation is to promote industrial safety with regard to the operation and maintenance of industrial boilers and prevent any untoward loss of life or property. This legislation mandates industrial units to register all industrial boilers with the designated authorities, and it also provides for periodic and surprise inspection in order to enforce the safety standards that have been prescribed for operation and maintenance of these industrial boilers. The legislation also tries to achieve uniformity with regard to the implementation of these safety standards, and it is focused on preventing the occurrence of such industrial disasters. But however, these safety standards prescribed under the Indian Boilers Act are very poorly enforced by the state authorities, because state governments have not really shown zero tolerance towards boiler accidents and other such related industrial disasters. Even though these disasters are very much preventable, it is the lack of adherence to these established safety protocols which leads to these repeated accidents. Because in the developed and the industrialized world, you will find that such industrial accidents are very rare because of their strict adherence to safety protocols and safety standards and due to strict enforcement by their authorities. So for a country like India, which aspires to establish itself as an industrialized nation in the future, it needs to work towards promoting industrial safety in order to prevent these industrial disasters. So the prevention strategy must be based on these following steps. First and foremost, the authorities need to ensure strict adherence to safety protocols by the industries which are operating such hazardous industrial equipment. All the prescribed safety standards have to be strictly enforced, and in the interest of occupational safety, it has to be ensured that any hazardous equipment is operated only by trained personnel who possess the required skills and expertise, as opposed to being operated by contract employees who may not possess the required expertise. Then there should be greater transparency in the process of inspection and safety audits in order to eliminate corruption at the lower levels. And despite these measures, if accidents do occur, then there has to be an independent investigation that has to be carried out in order to fix accountability and identify any negligence on the part of the owners. See, whenever such accidents occur, the priority of the central government and the state government is to just tackle public anger by announcing compensation to the victims. The editorial says that just providing compensation should not be the objective of the government. Instead, it should work towards fixing responsibility and accountability through an independent investigation, and it should work towards long-term reforms in order to promote industrial safety in India. Now let's take up a column from page number 6, in which the writer critically evaluates the role of the judiciary in preventing custodial deaths and torture. This column has been published in the context of the horrific custodial deaths that recently took place in the Thoothukudi district of Tamil Nadu, and we had covered this topic in detail on the 26th of June. In this column, the writer is evaluating as to how the judiciary can prevent custodial deaths and torture and uphold the fundamental rights of the citizens by holding the state actors, that is the police forces, accountable for their actions and for the violence and excesses that they commit that lead to the violation of fundamental rights. See, the Thoothukudi incident has clearly shown how the state actors, such as police forces, in whom we trust, can commit mindless acts of violence and excesses which can result in serious injuries and even death. So when there is such a gross violation of our fundamental rights by state actors, our only hope for redressal lies with the judiciary. In a country like India, where police forces in general are known to resort to excessive use of force and commit excesses, it is the judiciary which has time and again come to our rescue by trying to hold the police accountable for their acts of violence by pushing for police reforms. Various high courts, and especially the constitutional benches of the Supreme Court, have passed landmark judgments over the years that seek to prevent custodial deaths and torture by putting in place a system of checks and balances, and by putting in place a system which holds the police accountable for their acts of violence and for the excesses committed by them. The judiciary, especially the Supreme Court, has pushed for police reforms so much, and it has tried to put in place restrictions to prevent custodial deaths and torture, and this proactiveness of the judiciary, especially that of the Supreme Court, has led a number of scholars and legal experts to come to the conclusion that the Supreme Court is the only institution in India which is interested in pushing for police reforms. And this goes on to show the lack of interest of the state, that is the government, in pushing for police reforms and in holding the police forces accountable for their violence and excesses. There are a couple of landmark cases in the 1990s which shows how the Supreme Court has tried to restrict the arbitrary powers of the police. This includes the Joginder Kumar case of 1994 against the state of Uttar Pradesh and the D.K. Basu case of 1997 against the state of West Bengal. In these cases, the Supreme Court passed a landmark judgment and it managed to secure a couple of rights to the citizens in order to protect them against custodial death and custodial torture. Through these judgments, the Supreme Court secured the right to life and right to know for the accused, and it issued a set of guidelines which has effectively curbed the powers of the police to arrest the accused, and it mandates the police forces to inform the accused and his immediate family members and friends prior to being arrested, and the police forces have been mandated to share all critical information with the accused and his immediate family members and friends so that it can prevent the police forces from abusing and assaulting the accused while in custody. So these judgments of the Supreme Court brought out a set of guidelines which secured the right to life and right to know for the accused, and it placed restrictions on their custody and arrest, which in turn acts as a system of checks and balances against the abuse of power by the police forces. These guidelines of the Supreme Court were codified and given statutory backing by amending the Code of Criminal Procedure in 2008. Then through the landmark Prakash Singh case of 2006, the Supreme Court gave a major push to police reforms, and it came out with a set of 7 directives that the state governments were supposed to implement by coming out with a dedicated legislation. A couple of these directives focused on ensuring police accountability and on the establishment of a grievance redressal mechanism in order to receive complaints against the police forces. But unfortunately, most state governments have failed to pass such a legislation and they are in contempt of court. A few states which have passed such a legislation, such as Tamil Nadu, have diluted the provisions and hence they have eroded the very purpose of these 7 directives. The implementation of police reforms as mandated by the Supreme Court in the Prakash Singh case is often treated as a case of judicial overreach, as the Supreme Court clearly entered into the domain of the executive and the legislature. But despite this, we cannot ignore the fact that it is only the Supreme Court which has shown some real interest in pushing for police reforms. Such reforms have become absolutely essential to hold the police forces accountable and prevent them from committing such excesses and such mindless acts of violence. The judiciary has even tried to cut down the opportunities available for police to use torture as an investigative technique by relying more upon scientific investigation driven by technology. The judiciary has made a deliberate switch to rely more upon evidence collected through scientific investigation techniques such as CCTV footage, narco analysis, forensics, etc. So as the judiciary has come to rely more upon evidence collected through scientific investigative techniques, it discourages the police forces from resorting to torture as an investigative technique. But despite all these efforts of the judiciary, custodial deaths and torture continues to occur on a frequent basis in India, and hence it is high time for the constitutional courts to realize that they need to change the practices that are being followed by the local magistrates while allowing the police forces to take custody of the suspect or the accused. Because see, at the end of the day, no matter what guidelines and judgments the constitutional courts can come up with, at the end of the day, the enforcement of these guidelines is done by the local magistrates. The law mandates that the police have to bring the accused who has been taken into custody in front of the local magistrate within a period of 24 hours after his arrest in order to seek further custody. So all the checks and balances that have been built by the constitutional courts by issuing guidelines and by passing landmark judgments have to be followed and implemented by the local magistrates in order to have the desired effect. So for this purpose, the high courts and the constitutional benches of the Supreme Court should consider changing the practices of local magistrates in order to ensure their strict adherence to the guidelines that have been issued by the higher courts, because at the end of the day, magistrate courts are subordinate to these higher courts. Then the writer says that in cases of custodial death and torture, the judiciary usually tends to give out lower punishment to the police officers who have been held guilty by citing that harsher punishment could affect the morale of the entire police force. The writer says that this is a flawed approach of the judiciary because the only way through which such criminal acts by the police can be prevented is by delivering exemplary punishment to the police officers who are involved in the crime. The writer says that since police forces function as a cohesive unit, it should be the entire force which should share the responsibility for such incidents. And hence, by citing the morale of the force, lower punishment should not be delivered to the guilty police officers. So the writer concludes by saying that the constitutional courts should take indirect responsibility for such incidents and for the failure of the entire system of checks and balances in preventing such incidents. And they need to push towards changing the practices of local magistrates in order to ensure their adherence to the guidelines and the judgments that have been passed by the constitutional courts. Now let's take up another column from page number 6. The government of Assam has recently promulgated a law that makes the Assamese language compulsory in all schools, including public schools and private schools. The writer of this column evaluates the impact of this law on the diverse tribal society of Assam. See, the mandatory inclusion of the Assamese language in all schools has been extended across the state except for the Barak Valley, the Bodoland Council areas and the 6 scheduled areas which enjoy constitutional protection. There are also reports that the government is considering to make the knowledge of the Assamese language at the matriculation level a requirement for government jobs. The writer says that such unilateral imposition of a language in order to promote Assamese nationalism and homogenize the Assamese society will have a disastrous impact on tribal languages that are spoken by other tribes, such as the Missing, Dioris, Rabas, Sonowal Kacharis, who do not enjoy any constitutional protection. The writer says that such attempts at homogenization affects diversity and inclusivity, which could in turn create a social divide leading to internal conflicts. The writer says that basing the Assamese identity and the spirit of Aksumiya on the basis of language is an incorrect approach, and instead it should be based on one's domicile in the state of Assam. The writer says that the criteria for defining Assamese identity and the spirit of Aksumiya should not be based on one's ability to speak the Assamese language, but instead the Assamese identity should be shared amongst all the tribes and native communities that are domiciled in the state of Assam. The writer also points out that anyways, the other tribes which speak their own native tribal languages, they are also well versed and very fluent in the Assamese language as well, because the Assamese language is the language of currency in the state of Assam. So forcefully trying to define Assamese identity on the basis of one's ability to speak the Assamese language would be similar to the assumption that all Hindus are Hindi speakers and imposing the Hindi language on non-Hindi speakers. The writer cautions that any attempt to homogenize the ethnically diverse society of Assam by imposing the Assamese language on the other tribes could create a social divide and result in conflicts, and the Official Language Bill of 1960 is the best example for this. Because this bill, which also tried to impose the Assamese language, resulted in a backlash in the Khasi Hill areas of Meghalaya, leading to the statehood movement, which resulted in the formation of Meghalaya, and it also laid the foundation for the Bodo movement as well. In fact, even in India's neighborhood, we have seen that any attempt to impose a majoritarian language and any attempt to discriminate against linguistic minorities has resulted in a backlash, resulting in conflicts, which can rupture peace and harmony in the society. Take, for example, the conflict between the Sinhalese and the Tamils in Sri Lanka, or the conflict between Bengali speakers and Urdu speakers in East Pakistan. All these examples show that seeking homogenization of the society on the basis of one language could be counterproductive, and hence the state, that is the government, should always respect the diversity of its people and provide for inclusive policies which takes into account the interests of the minority groups as well. The writer also says that the politics of language in the state of Assam could destroy the unity that was built amongst native Assamese speakers and other non-Assamese tribes during the Anti-Citizenship Amendment Act protests. During the anti-CAA protests, native Assamese speakers and as well as other tribes which do not speak the Assamese language, they were united in their opposition to illegal migration from Bangladesh. But the writer says that the politics of language and the attempt to impose the Assamese language could break this unity, which could divide the Assamese society, resulting in the breakout of internal conflicts. Now let's take up an article from page number 9. The Ministry of Home Affairs has designated 9 individuals belonging to various Khalistan terror outfits as terrorists under the Unlawful Activities Prevention Act. These individuals belong to various Khalistan terror outfits such as the Babar Khalsa International, the Khalistan Commando Force, the Khalistan Zindabad Force, etc. According to Indian security and intelligence agencies, these terror elements were known to operate out of foreign countries such as Pakistan, Germany, United States, United Kingdom, Canada, etc. This also goes on to show the international linkages of the Khalistan terror outfits that seek to establish Punjab as a separate country for the Sikhs, known as Khalistan. It goes on to show the support that they enjoy amongst few members of the diaspora community in these countries. And it also goes on to show the covert support that these groups enjoy as a part of Pakistan's proxy war against India. So 9 individuals belonging to these Khalistan terror outfits have been designated as terrorists by the Ministry of Home Affairs under the provisions of the Unlawful Activities Prevention Act. This law is India's primary anti-terror legislation, which was first introduced in 1967. Over the years, it has been amended a number of times, including the amendments that were carried out in 2004, 2008, 2013, and most recently in 2019, in order to update the law and make it more suited to deal with modern-day terrorism. Amongst these amendments, the amendments that were introduced in 2004 and 2019 are particularly important because the 2004 amendment allowed the Government of India to proscribe terror organizations and ban them under the law. And as per this provision, terror outfits such as the Lashkar-e-Taiba, Jaish-e-Mohammed, etc. have been declared as banned and proscribed organizations under the UAPA. Then the latest amendment, which was introduced in 2019, has empowered the Ministry of Home Affairs to declare individual terrorists and designate them as terrorists under the UAPA. These provisions are quite similar to the anti-terror laws that exist in other countries as well, such as the United States, in European Union countries, in China, in Israel, and even in Pakistan and Sri Lanka. But the inclusion of this provision last year had raised a lot of concerns amongst the opposition parties, because allowing the government to designate individuals as terrorists is definitely a much needed tool in India's counter-terrorism efforts. But it also opens up the law for potential misuse by the government, and opposition parties fear that the government might misuse these provisions to target opposition leaders and political dissidents under the pretext of false terror charges. But the government has justified the need for such provisions, and over the last 1 year, it has designated a number of individuals such as Masood Azhar, Hafiz Saeed, Zaki-ur-Rehman Lakhvi, Dawood Ibrahim and the others as terrorists in order to enable India's fight against state-sponsored terrorism. Now let's take up another article from page number 9. The Election Commission of India has decided to extend the postal ballot service to more categories of voters, and it has informed this decision to all the political parties in order to hold further consultations. See, postal ballot is nothing but the option of casting one's vote remotely through a postal ballot, and this facility is extended to certain category of voters who are not in a position to go back to their respective constituencies and cast their vote on the voting day. This includes government officials who are a part of the electoral process. It includes personnel of the armed forces, Indian diplomats who are posted abroad, etc. The Representation of the People Act of 1951 empowers the Election Commission of India to extend postal ballot service to any voter. So by using this provision, the Election Commission has decided to extend the postal ballot service in the upcoming elections to several categories of voters considering the impact of the COVID-19 pandemic. The Election Commission has decided to extend the postal ballot service to those who are above the age of 65 years, because this age group is the most vulnerable to the pandemic. Then along with this, to further contain the spread of the pandemic and at the same time to ensure voter participation in the elections, the Election Commission has decided to extend the postal ballot service to those who have been infected with COVID-19 or to those who have been quarantined for being suspected cases of COVID-19. Apart from this, in 2019, the Election Commission had recommended the extension of the postal ballot service to three other categories of electors, which includes those who are above the age of 80 years, voters suffering with disabilities, and a list of notified essential services workers. This recommendation of the Election Commission had been notified in October 2019 itself. Now let's take up an article from page number 10. The Central Zoo Authority has been reconstituted by the Ministry of Environment, Forest and Climate Change. See, the Central Zoo Authority is a statutory body that is under the Environment Ministry, which has been established under Section 38A of the Wildlife Protection Act of 1972. The Central Zoo Authority is headed by a chairman who is none other than the Environment Minister, and he is assisted by a set of 10 members and a member secretary. Earlier, most of these members used to be government officials, especially from the Environment Ministry. They used to be retired officers, and if any non-government independent experts were included, they would usually be wildlife conservationists and environmental activists. But for the first time, the composition of the Central Zoo Authority has been slightly reconstituted to provide for the inclusion of few journalists, architects, and molecular biologists as independent experts in the Central Zoo Authority. The primary role of this organization is to regulate all the zoos in the country, and as per the provisions of the Wildlife Protection Act, every zoo in the country has to obtain recognition from the Central Zoo Authority. And along with this, all the zoos in India, they need to maintain the standards that have been prescribed by the Central Zoo Authority. Another key function of the Central Zoo Authority is that it lays down the guidelines for the transfer and exchange of animals, especially the endangered and threatened animals, both domestically and as well as internationally. While transferring and exchanging endangered animals internationally, the Central Zoo Authority needs to ensure that all the required clearances, as mandated by the Wildlife Protection Act, the Export-Import Policy, and the CITES Convention, has to be obtained. Now let's take up an article from page number 16, which can be important for prelims. Two new species of butterflies have been discovered in Arunachal Pradesh. This includes the striped hair streak, which is usually found in China, and the elusive prince, which is considered to be native to Vietnam. The discovery of these two new species of butterflies points to the rich biodiversity of Arunachal Pradesh, and the striped hair streak was discovered in Vijayanagar, located on Arunachal's border with Myanmar, and the elusive prince was discovered in the Namdapa National Park of Arunachal Pradesh. The discovery of these two new species of butterflies comes immediately after the rediscovery of the Assam keelback, which is a non-venomous snake that was rediscovered after a gap of 129 years. Now let's take up the practice questions for today. Which of the following statements are correct? In the interest of menstrual hygiene, sanitary napkins have been recognized as an essential commodity under the Essential Commodity Act of 1955. The Ministry of Health and Family Welfare has been implementing the scheme for promotion of menstrual hygiene amongst adolescent girls in the age group of 10 to 19 years, primarily in rural areas, as a part of the Rashtriya Kishore Swasthya Karyakram under the National Health Mission. Menstrual hygiene management is an integral part of the Swachh Bharat Mission guidelines, and accordingly, the Menstrual Hygiene Management National Guidelines has been issued by the Ministry of Drinking Water and Sanitation. Amongst the given statements, the first statement is incorrect, so option D is the right answer. The first statement is incorrect because sanitary napkins have not been recognized as an essential commodity under the Essential Commodity Act of 1955. This question has been asked because, according to this article, a petition has been filed at the Bombay High Court seeking the Ministry of Health and Family Welfare to list sanitary napkins as an essential commodity under the Essential Commodities Act. Then please note that the Ministry of Health and Family Welfare implements the scheme for promotion of menstrual hygiene amongst adolescent girls in the age group of 10 to 19 years as a part of the Rashtriya Kishore Swasthya Karyakram under the National Health Mission. Then under the Swachh Bharat Mission, the Ministry of Drinking Water and Sanitation has come out with the Menstrual Hygiene Management National Guidelines in 2015. Now let's take up the next practice question. The World Investment Report is published by the United Nations Conference on Trade and Development. Option D is the right answer. This question has been asked because, according to this column on page number 7, the United Nations Conference on Trade and Development has published its latest version of the World Investment Report, according to which FDI inflow into Asian economies is set to decline by as much as 45%. So in the context of these predictions made by UNCTAD in its World Investment Report, the writer of this column argues that India needs to reform its digital policy in order to attract FDI and advance its goal of becoming a $5 trillion economy. Now let's take up the next practice question. Which of the following can be identified as environmental threats or challenges that are specific to the ecologically sensitive Sundarbans mangrove forests? Tropical cyclones in the Bay of Bengal, rising sea levels, increasing salinity, transboundary nature of the ecosystem. All the four are correct. Option D is the right answer. See, the Sundarbans is an ecologically sensitive ecosystem that is located in the delta areas formed by the confluence of the Ganga, Brahmaputra, and the Meghna rivers on the coast of the Bay of Bengal. This sensitive and biodiverse ecosystem is known for its mangrove forests, its wetlands, agricultural lands, mudflats, and barren land that is intersected by multiple tidal streams and channels formed by the riverine network of the Ganga, Brahmaputra, and the Meghna rivers that drain into the Bay of Bengal. It is a transboundary ecosystem that stretches from the Hooghly River in India to the Baleshwar River in Bangladesh. And this transboundary nature poses problem of coordination with regard to conservation of the ecosystem. Then apart from this, the Sundarban ecosystem is threatened by cyclones in the Bay of Bengal. It is threatened by increasing sea levels and rising salinity, which is a result of climate change. And also note that the Sundarbans has been designated as a UNESCO World Heritage Site. It is also a biosphere reserve. And recently, India has got Sundarbans listed as a Ramsar site under the Ramsar Convention. The entire Sundarbans ecosystem is comprised of a national park, a tiger reserve, and as well as a few wildlife sanctuaries. This question has been asked because according to this article on page number 11, the Chief Minister of West Bengal has written to the Vice Chairman of Niti Aayog seeking a master plan for the socio-economic development of the Sundarbans. Now let's take up a practice question from the 2016 prelims paper. What is the purpose of district mineral foundations in India? Promoting mineral exploration activities in mineral-rich districts, protecting the interests of the persons affected by mining operations, authorizing state governments to issue licenses for mineral exploration. The correct answer is option B, 2 only. Finally, let's take up a couple of mains practice questions. The first question: frequent occurrence of deadly industrial accidents such as boiler blasts point to the low priority that laws and protocols get. Examine the measures that need to be taken to promote safe industrial practices. The second question: critically evaluate the role of the judiciary while dealing with cases of custodial deaths and police excesses. Kindly write an answer to these questions and post your answers in the comment section below. So this concludes our discussion for the day. Thanks for watching.